The boast of heraldry, the pomp of power, and all that beauty, all that wealth ever gave, awaits alike the inevitable hour. The paths of glory led but to the grave. Death makes no distinction between the wealthy and the poor, between the simple and the proud. The inevitable hour overtakes them all. Death is not irved by the pomp and glory of the rich and the powerful. It strikes them with the same inevitability as it does the common people. Nor you, a proud, impute to these the fault, if memory over their tomb no trophies raise, where through the long-drawn aisle and fretted vault the pealing anthem swells a note of praise. The poet warns the proud people against finding fault with the peasants for the absence of memorials over their graves or of anthems in their praise. He says that memorials and anthems, grant though they may be, cannot bring the dead back to life. Can storied urn or animated bust back to its mansion call the fleeting breath? Can hour's voice provoke the silent dust, or flattery soothe the dull, cold ear of death? The poet here asks two questions. The answer to these questions is no. That is to say, neither storied urn. Urn means a tombstone with inscriptions on it. So neither the storied urn or animated bust. It's a lifelike statue. So both of these cannot bring the fleeting breath, or cannot bring the death back to the life. And this is also true of Horner's voice and flattery. Perhaps in this neglected spot is laid some heart once pregnant with celestial fire, hands that the road of empire might have swayed, or wake to ecstasy the living lyre. Drawing our attention to a particular spot, the poet says that there in that spot is laid the body of a person who was full of divine inspiration. He could have ruled an empire, given the opportunity, or could have roused others to great heights of joy with his lyre. So here the poet stresses the lack of opportunities to the villagers in their lifetime, and the fact that if they were given the opportunities, some of them could have become rulers, poets, or musicians. But knowledge to their eyes, her ample page, rich with the spoils of time, did never unroll. Chill penury repressed their noble rage and froze the genial current of the soul. The villagers did not have access to knowledge. They did not get education. The poet bewails their lack of opportunities to imbibe the wealth of knowledge that was developed through the ages. It was acute poverty that kept them away from, you know, their passion of their passion for knowledge, and that paralyzed their natural urge for learning. Full many a gem of purest ray serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bear. Full many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert air. In this passage, we have two images. Both convey the universality of tragic waste. The first image is that of gems of purest quality lying at the bottom of the ocean that cannot be reached. The second image is that of sweet-smelling flowers that waste their fragrance on the desert air. Both images speak of the gifted, talented villagers who, having had no opportunities to develop their talents, waste their qualities of head and heart without being of any use to mankind. The beauty of the gems lying at the bottom of the ocean and the sweet smell of the flowers in the desert are wasted without being enjoyed by men. Similarly, the ill-developed talents and gifts of the villagers are lost to mankind. Their talents remain dormant and are devoid of any use to mankind. Some village Hamden that with dauntless breast, the little tyrant of his fields withstood, some mute inglorious Milton here may rest, some Cromwell guiltless of his country's blood. Among the villagers laid to rest in the churchyard, there would have been men of consequence. Some village Hamden. Here, Hamden refers to John Hamden, who had the courage to refuse payment of ship money demanded by Charles I, as his tax did not have the consent of Parliament. Then some would have become mute, inglorious Milton, John Milton, the English poet, or some Cromwell, Oliver Cromwell, who rose from obscurity to become the leader of the parliamentary party, which defeated the royalists in the Great Civil War and put Charles I to death. The village Cromwell was, however, not guilty of shedding the blood of his countrymen. The applause of listening senates to command, the threats of pain and ruin to despise, to scatter plenty over a smiling land and read their history in a nation's eyes. The humble lot of the villagers prevented them from becoming martyrs to some worthy cause or other. It denied the glory of martyrdom, the applause of the Senate, and the opportunity to contribute to the happiness and prosperity of their country by their wise statesmanship. The villagers had no opportunities to rise high. Their humble lot prevented them from winning loud shouts of approval from listening senates, from treating with contempt threats of pain and ruin, from making their country happy and plentiful, and from going down in history in the eyes of fellow citizens.